Thank you. So my name's Dustin. I'm DI on GitHub. I'm a Python developer. I'm a contributor to Warehouse, which is the open source replacement for the Python package index. And I'm a developer at PromptWorks, which is a software consultancy in Philadelphia. PromptWorks got its start a few years ago as a Ruby shop, and most of our reputation is for working with Ruby. But we actually work with a lot of different languages, and these days it's more Python than anything else. It's actually all that I do. But we still have some Ruby devs who are occasionally writing Python, which means that every now and then we get questions like this in our Slack. So Jeff is writing Python, and he wants to create an empty object and just start assigning properties to it, because he's a good developer and he's lazy. But he doesn't want to have to define a class. So if you know Jeff, you would know that he's usually irked. But he has a pretty good question here. And when I saw this, I asked myself, why can't you do that? So I fired up my interpreter, and I typed J equals object, open close paren, because I know that object is a built-in name in Python, and it's instantiable, this works fine. Next thing I do is I type j.hi equals the string there. And I also know that this is how you set an attribute on an object instance. This is pretty basic Python, right? However, this does not work. We get an attribute error that says object object has no attribute hi. Why does this happen? This seems very counterintuitive, right? Of course it doesn't have that attribute. We are trying to set it. But why doesn't it work? So I'm about to tell you, but first, let's talk for a little bit about type. The type built in Python tells us it can be used as a function that tells us what something is. You can pass it just about anything as its first argument, and the return value is a type object. So let's have a little quiz with some examples of how type is used. And please shout out the answers if you know them. So the first one is an easy one. What is the type of this list? Anyone? List, right. All right, what is the type of the built-in list? I heard class, I heard type, some other things. So just to be clear, I'm not talking about an instantiated list, because we can instantiate a list like this, and it gives us an empty list, and that would be a class list. What I'm asking about is the type built-in, and that is actually a class of type. All right. What is the type of the built-in type? I heard object, I heard something else, I heard someone say type, which is correct. The type of type is itself. It's type. It's turtles all the way down. All right, some more. What is the type of none? I'm sure everyone's seen this before. None type. None type has no attribute, blah, blah, blah. You probably get that a lot. What's the type of this function? So just an empty function named func. Anyone? It's function. Which makes sense, but wait, function isn't a built-in like list. We don't write function func, we write def func. So where do these come from? There is a module in the standard library called types. And if you import it, they are all there. So while we have types imported, we can get our same function type this way as well, just from that types module. So while we've got types imported, what's the type of types? List. It's actually a module type. This is a module that we've imported, which kind of makes sense. And this is the last one, one more. If I define this class called a foo class, what is the type of foo class? Anyone know? Type. So again, I'm not talking about an instantiated foo class, because that would just be open close parens. It would be a foo class. I'm talking about the class itself. And this is a trick question, because this depends on your Python version, right? In Python 2, this is a class obj type. In Python 3, or as I like to call it, Python, it is a type class, just like list and just like type itself. And just to make this a little bit more confusing, in Python 2, you can also do this. You can inherit foo class from object. And you've probably heard this before. We call this new style classes because it gives us a type of type, and it's basically the same thing that you would get in Python. Three. And just to be clear, from here on out, we're only going to talk about Python, not Python 2. Whatever. Thanks. So let's review. When we call type on something like the number 42, what do we get? It tells us that it is an int, yes, but also we get a class. What we think of as the int type here is really just the int class. And from this, we can realize that the int keyword is just the name of a class. And what do we know about classes? They are instantiable. So instantiating the type of 42 is the same thing as just instantiating an int. In both cases, we get zero. So if the type is just a class, and calling type with an argument, such as 42, gives us the class, perhaps we can just create a new class dynamically by instantiating type. Sounds like a pretty good idea. Unfortunately, this does not work. However, the error is a little promising. It gives us a type error. Type takes one or three arguments. So one argument would just give us the type of that argument. That's what we were doing before over and over again. So what would be the three arguments that we provide to type? Well, let's think about what we do when we create a new class. When you're doing it manually, what do you need to define when you're writing out a class? You need to give it the name of the class. You need to specify what the class inherits from. But if it's just object and you're using Python, then this can be implicit. And the third thing is any attributes on that class. So the three arguments that we can pass to type are the name of the class as a string, base classes as a tuple, and attributes as a dictionary. And this works. We get a new class. And if you've been paying attention, you may have realized that we've now come full circle. Technically, hi here is a class attribute and not an instance attribute, but the functionality is the same as what Jeff originally wanted when he posted his question. And if we really wanted to get fancy, we don't actually need to specify a class name, because an empty string is still a string, or any base classes, because object is implicit. And we don't even need to specify any attributes when we're declaring type. So that looks terrible. And I guarantee if you try to commit that, your teammates will not let you. But it works. And as a side note, if you find yourself wanting to do this, because it is pretty handy sometimes, I would strongly recommend you check out Alex Gaynor's excellent module, Pretend, which lets you basically do the exact same thing, but it calls them stubs. And this is super useful for testing, and it's far more readable. OK, now let's talk about metaclasses. A wise man once wrote, "The subject of metaclasses in Python has caused hairs to raise and even brains to explode." Anyone know who said that? It was Guido, of course. I promise none of your brains will explode. But in fact, at the core, I think the idea of metaclasses is quite simple and can be shown with an equally simple analogy. Classes are to instances as metaclasses are to classes. Classes create new instances. Metaclasses create new classes. The word metaclass just means that it's one abstraction from a class. It has nothing to do with metadata or anything like that. So can anyone name a metaclass in Python? Type, yes, thank you. We just learned this. Type is, in fact, a metaclass. We can use it to create new classes. So how do we create a new metaclass just like type? Well, it's pretty simple also. A metaclass is still just a class, after all. And since type is also a class, we can extend from it. We can inherit from it. And then how do we attach this to our class? We use a keyword argument. Metaclass equals my meta. So there we have a metaclass and a class that is using that metaclass. And they do nothing. So to make metaclasses actually useful, we have to override new. But this time, new is not going to return an instance like you would normally do when overriding dunder new for an object. It's returning a class. And using super here is just like calling type with the names, bases, and adders, but just returns a new class. By the way, there are a lot of names for all of these fields here, names, bases, and adders. There's not much consistency. This is just what I like best. So to be clear, if I insert a line here in new, this line gets printed when the class is first created, when this class is imported. When we initialize a class, dunder call gets called. And so we can see that when we, down below, we initialize the foo class, that print is given. So it has also been said that metaclasses are deeper magic than 99% of users should ever worry about. If you wonder whether you need them, you don't. And the people who actually need them know with certainty that they need them and don't need an explanation about why. As Tim Peters. So in the spirit of this, I am not going to tell you why you need metaclasses, because only you can really know that for sure. I haven't seen your code base. However, if I don't show you some examples of how one can use metaclasses, you'll never know that the magic is even available to you. So here's a somewhat contrived example that I'm going to call Metadog. So let's imagine that we have a dog class, which we have written for our client. I'm a consultant, so that's what we're going to work with. And the requirements call for a single function, sit, which makes the dog sit when we tell it to. This is great. Now let's imagine our client comes back to us and says, actually, we forgot. We need the dog to make a dog noise whenever it does anything. And so we say, OK, no problem. We'll make a small patch, and it's done. And then the client comes back to us again and says, actually, we need the dog to be able to stay as well. It's rather useless to have a dog that sits but doesn't stay. And so we make another quick patch and hack it in there, but then more feedback comes back from the client, and they say, all right, that's great, but we did some user testing, and the growl is making the dog seem too aggressive, and the users are now scared. Can we make it woof instead? And so we look at our code, and we think, all right, we're changing a lot of things here. The requirements are kind of flying around. Let's dry it up a bit. We'll put our woof in a private woof function, and we'll call that from sit and stay, and then we remember, we heard about those things called decorators, so we go to the functools docs and we copy this decorator, and we add our woof statement, and then we decorate our sit and stay functions and pat ourselves on the back, because this is pretty good Python. And then the client says, well, we'd like the dog to be able to play dead too, is that possible? And we say, well, we think we can get it done this sprint. And we do it. We write one more patch and we deploy it to prod, and then, oh no, we have a bug in production. We forgot to decorate the play dead function, and now dogs are not woofing when they are rolling over. Users are very confused. They think their dogs are actually dead. And we wish to ourselves, wouldn't it be so great if we could just automatically decorate every function in this class to meet the original requirements that a dog makes a dog noise whenever it does anything? And then we remember metaclasses. So let's write a metaclass. First, we'll import the isFunction function from the inspect module, and I'll explain why in a second. Then, we'll write our metadog metaclass, which we'll inherit from type. We want to squeeze in between the class definition and its instantiation, because we're going to change the class as we do it. So we'll override dunder new, which, like I said before, takes these four arguments, meta, name, bases, and adders, the last three being the same things that we can provide to type. These functions we have defined are tucked away in the adders dict. So when we are creating our new class, they're already in there waiting for us. So we'll iterate over it for name adder in adders.items. And we'll use that inspect isFunction function that we imported before to see if it is truly a function that we want to override. And if it is, we'll wrap it in our woof decorator. And this overrides the original function in the adders dict, right? So now we have taken all the functions, we've wrapped them in woof, and we've put them back where they were originally. And the last thing we'll do is we'll call new of our parent class, which is just type here, and with the same arguments we originally had, but now we've wrapped all the functions, and we'll return it. And so we'll add it to our dog class with the metaclass argument, as so. And now our code looks a lot cleaner, and it actually works. We can instantiate a new dog. We say dog.sit, and woof is printed. Dog.playdead, woof, it also woofs as well. So what have we found? We use metaclasses to dynamically control the creation of a class. Let's go back to thinking about regular classes for a second. When you instantiate a class twice, you get two different instances, right? If I set some attribute on A, B does not change. They're two different instances. A singleton is a design pattern which breaks this convention and allows the class to be instantiated only once. And any subsequent tries to instantiate it get back the first instance. So let's implement a singleton class just with regular classes, not with metaclasses. The goal here is to make A and B end up being the same, as you can see down at the bottom. So we'll give it a class variable, underscore instance, to hold the instance. Originally, it's none. Then we'll override the new method. not the init method. The new method is responsible for returning the instance, right? If cls.instance is none, this is the very first time that we are trying to initialize this class. We actually do the initialization, set instance to be the new instance, and regardless, we return class.instance. It works, great. We don't even need metaclasses at all. So the biggest potential problem to this approach is with multiple inheritance. Foo class could have another base class, which overrides dunder new, and we'd have to think way harder than it is necessary. So what we really want is a way to control the creation of each foo class. Sounds like a pretty good job for metaclasses. So we can use this new knowledge to write a singleton metaclass. And first things first, like I said before, it inherits from type. We'll override dunder new, and we'll give the class an attribute, instance, just like we did before, and set it to none. So this is functionally the same. And we will return a new class. This is the same as calling type.new, right? Except using super, it's resolving the inheritance issues here for us. Next, we'll override dunder call. If the instance class attribute is not set, this is the very first time we've tried to call dunder call. And so we'll instantiate a new class, instantiate a new instance, store it, and finally return the value of the instance. So why is this better? Because it will not be messed up by the class inheritance. So what have we learned here? We can use metaclasses to control the instance being returned for a given class. And this is pretty useful. So if Jeff were in the audience today, he would still be a little irked because I didn't answer his original question. So let's go back. We figured out that we could achieve basically the same thing using type, or potentially with using stub, but why doesn't Python let us do this? And the message that we're getting here is actually setAdder failing, because objects, when we instantiate just the built-in object, it has no dict, no dunder dict. And why? Because object is what we call the featureless base type of all built-in types. It has no features. There's nothing to it. It just serves as the pinnacle for what everything has descended from. And another reason for this you might consider is that it would be pretty big if every object had its own dict. And there's no reason for something like an integer to have attributes or dict in it. So here we can see that a plain object, these units are in bytes. A plain object is 16 bytes. Size of an integer is 24 bytes. And size of a dict and foo class is much larger. So to conclude, we learned a few things. We learned that the type built-in always gives us classes. And we learned that this is the bare minimum to create a new class. And we also learned that we probably don't want to do that. We learned that when creating a metaclass, you inherit from type. And we learned to give a class a metaclass, we use a keyword arg. All that, and I didn't see any exploding brains, so not bad. Thank you, everyone.
Awesome. So let's kick it up for 5 minutes of Q&A.
Sure.
So there's a mic here. You're welcome to form a line if you want to ask questions.
When you're making a class with type and you give it attributes, some of those can be callables. What if you wanted them to be like static methods or class methods instead of just normal callables or bound?
Sure. So the question was, instead of just making them plain attributes like strings or callables like functions, or if we wanted them to be static methods or class methods. So the way we declare a static method or a class method is with a decorator. And so we can, in the same way, decorate those functions. It doesn't look quite as nice, but you would just basically wrap that function with, or wrap that thing that you want to make a static method with the name of that decorator.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thanks, everyone.